وهل أتاك حديث موسى إذ رأى نارا فقال لأهلهم كثوا إني آنست نارا لعلي آتيكم منها بقبس أو أجد على النار هدى.
بسم الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وبعد. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إذ أوحينا إلى أمك ما يوحى أن اقذفيه في التابوت فاقذفيه في اليم فليلقه اليم بالساحل يأخذه عدو لي وعدو له وألقيت عليك محبة مني ولتصنع على عيني. صدق الله العظيم. We concluded on discussing the 38th verse of Surah Taha, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had reminded Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam that we have accepted your request now, and previously as well we had favored you in many ways when you were a child and you were a kid and you were an infant, and the environment around you was hostile, with the Pharaoh killing tens of hundreds of people. So we're going to first do a translation of the ayah inshallah, and then we're going to switch to a story format of the entire tale and narrative as captured by Sheikh Abul Hasan Ali Nadwi rahimahullah, who we all know was a very, very prolific author and writer, in his famous book Qasas al-Nabiyyin in Al-Juz al-Thalith. So in the verse that we recited, that is the 39th verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to Sayyidina Musa, to the mother of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, narrating those events, أَنِقْذِفِيهِ فِي التَّابُوتِ. O Musa, we favored you at a time when we had inspired your mom. أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَىٰ أُمِّكَ مَا يُوحَىٰ أَنِقْذِفِيهِ فِي التَّابُوتِ. That place your child, that is you, O Musa, فِي التَّابُوتِ, in a box, in a chest, in a basket. فَقْذِفِيهِ فِي الْيَمِّ. قَذَفَ يَقْذِفُ, and of course it's addressing the mother of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. So it's the expression of a female sigha, as we would say. فَقْذِفِيهِ فِي الْيَمْ, and then place the basket in the River Nile. Place the chest in the River Nile. فَلْيُلْقِيهِ الْيَمُّ بِالسَّاحِلِ, and then the water will wash the basket to the shore. So the instruction, the command of the Almighty to your mother, O Musa, was, while everyone was in panic, in fear, in anxiety, because of the intelligence of Pharaoh, because of the cruelty and the tyranny of Pharaoh, we told your mom that mistake you, O Musa, while you were unaware because you were a child, to place you in the basket and place the basket in the River Nile. فَلْيُلْقِهِ الْيَمُّ بِالسَّاحِلِ, the water will push you to the bank and the shore. يَأْخُذْهُ عَدُوٌ لِي وَعَدُوٌ لَهُ. These words of the ayah are just too amazing. You know what Allah says precisely? يَأْخُذْهُ عَدُوٌ لِي وَعَدُوٌ لَهُ, that the water will wash the basket to the shore, and I have dispatched my enemy and Musa's enemy to receive him. يَأْخُذْهُ عَدُوٌ لِي, my enemy and Moses' enemy will receive him. This was the discussion we had conveyed to your mom through inspiration, O Musa, at a time you were unaware of. At a time you were unaware of. Sometimes a father tells his son comes and asks for a favor, I need some money, I need a car, I need a loan, I need this year. And at times it just triggers a nostalgia of a time back when this child was a baby, or probably he was just born and they needed a blood transfusion, or later in his life they needed a kidney or something, and the child was unaware that the parent had donated so much blood, or did, sometimes to a sibling, one sibling gives another sibling a kidney or an organ. So then you remind that person that today you're asking me of a favor, but hang on, you don't know there was a time in your life where you will not be able to recall where I had displayed such selflessness and kindness to you by donating or assisting or empowering, etc. So, oh Musa, at that time we told your mom to put you in the chest in the River Nile, the water will wash the chest to the shore, and your enemy and my enemy, and that was Pharaoh, يَأْخُذْهُ عَدُوٌ لِي وَعَدُوٌ لَهُ, will receive you and take you. Generally, we have unaccompanied minors that travel, and when they travel, there are guardians on either sides at the airports. So they hand it over to cabin crew and to the flight staff, but the guardian would see them off, and a guardian would receive them on the other end. But here Allah tells the mother, put him in and put the chest in the water. The water has been instructed to take him to the shore, and not a guardian to receive Musa alayhi salam. The enemy of Musa and the foe of Musa will come and receive him. يَأْخُذُهُ عَدُوٌ لِي وَعَدُوٌ لَهُ وَأَلْقَيْتُ عَلَيْكَ مَحَبَّةً مِنِّي. Wow. And what was the measure of protection around Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam? So try and understand this year that the entire nation is locked down, the whole of Egypt, everyone is by the command of Pharaoh to move, to locate, to identify, to apprehend, to intercept, to kill, to butcher, to massacre. This is this general royal decree of Pharaoh, and it's been executed right across the nation. And at that time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, this was our plan, and who can dare challenge the plan of Allah? Wallahu ghalibun ala amri. Allah has power over his matter. Inna Allaha balighu amri. Allah accomplishes his matter. So whatever Allah decrees will happen. وَمَا تَشَاءُونَ إِلَّا أَن يَشَاءَ اللَّهُ رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ. It only happens if Allah decrees. مَا شَئْتَ كَانَ وَإِن لَمْ أَشَأْ وَمَا شَئْتُ إِن لَمْ تَشَأْ لَمْ يَكُنْ خَلَقْتَ الْعِبَادَ لِمَا قَدْ عَلِمْتَ فَفِي الْعِلْمِ يَجْرِي الْفَتَى وَالْمُسِنْ فَمِنْهُمْ شَقِيٌّ وَسَعِيدٌ وَمِنْهُمْ حَسَنٌ وَقَبِيحٌ ذَا مَنَنْتَ وَهَذَا خَذَلْتَ وَذَا أَنْعَمْتَ وَهَذَا. It's a long poem in which the poet in essence captures these same sentiments. Allah says, وَأَلْقَيْتُ عَلَيْكَ مَحَبَّةً مِنِّي, and I had cast beauty on you. I had cast beauty. I had enveloped you with love and beauty. So whoever seen Musa alayhi salam was just mesmerized, was just attracted. Generally speaking, a child, any child, regular child, every child is sweet, is innocent, is adorable, is lovable. You just want to hug him, you want to embrace him, you want to pamper him, you want to mollycoddle him. That's just the common, regular, every child. Can you imagine, this is a child and this is a prophet, and then Allah makes mention that I had cast a special sense of beauty and affection on you. وَأَلْقَيْتُ عَلَيْكَ مَحَبَّةً مِنِّي وَلِتُصْنَعَ عَلَى عَيْنِي أي وَلِتُرَبَّ عَلَى حِفْظَتِي, so that you could grow up and you could be nurtured in my supervision and my protection. So that kind of gives us a translation of verse 39. Now let's just go into a detailed explanation of this entire sequence of events, in the manner in which his mom put him in the basket, how he reached the palace of Pharaoh, and the events that followed. So I take you into Qasas al-Nabiyyin al-Juz' al-Thalith, the writings of Sheikh Abu al-Hasan Ali Nadwi rahimahullah, under the heading Dhabhul Atfali, the killing, the merciless killing of babies. وَذَهَبَ كَاهِنٌ قِبْطِيٌ إِلَىٰ آلِ فِرْعَوْنَ. So a fortune teller went to Pharaoh and said to him, يُولَدُ مَوْلُود يَذْهَبُ مُلْكُكَ عَلَىٰ يَدِهِ. That I predict and I foresee that a child from Bani Israel will be born, and you will lose your kingdom and your empire at his hands. This is the prediction that was conveyed to Musa to Pharaoh. He writes here so beautifully, وَجُنَّ جُنُونُ فِرْعَوْنُ. Fir'aun's insanity, craziness, madness had no limits and no bounds. Yeah, that was the last day he had a peaceful sleep. He became restless. He was informed on the birth of a child, and the child will grow up and you will at some point lose your empire. وَأَمَرَ الشُّرْطَ أَن يَذْبَحُ كُلَّ مَوْلُودٍ يُولَدُ فِي بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ. So in his limited understanding, okay, we can nip this in the bud. we can control this year, we can avoid this, we can divert this year. And then he made a general decree, he issued a command that any male child that is born will be a threat to my empire, so just kill children, right? When the craze of power gets to a person, then I'm afraid there's no limit to the tyranny and the oppression that people can do. And history is filled with tyrants that have come and went across time. There were great, great tyrants and autocrats and dictators and butchers. But ultimately, like the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَيُمْلِي الظَّالِمِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَيُمْلِي الظَّالِمِ. Allah gives grace, clemency and respite to a tyrant. حَتَّى إِذَا أَخَذَهُ لَمْ يُفْلِتْهُ. And then when Allah intercepts him and Allah apprehends him, then there is simply no escape for him. And then the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam read the verse, وَكَذَلِكَ أَخْذُ رَبِّكَ إِذَا أَخَذَ الْقُرَى وَهِيَ ظَالِمَةً إِنَّ أَخْذَهُ أَلِيمٌ شَدِيدٌ. And thus is the grasp of your Lord when he grips. إِذَا أَخَذَ وَكَذَلِكَ أَخْذُ رَبِّكَ إِذَا أَخَذَ الْقُرَى. When he apprehends or takes to task any town, locality or individual, وَهِيَ ظَالِمَةٌ, because of their tyranny and their oppressive nation nature, then none can be rescued from the grip and the torment or, and the punishment of the Almighty. وَكَانَ فِرْعَوْنُ يَرَى أَنَّهُ رَبُّ النَّاسِ يَذْبَحُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيَتْرُكُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. And because of the grace and the clemency that Allah gave Pharaoh, he thought, wait, hang on, I'm as good as a lord. So I will decide, I'll kill you, I'll leave you. So it's tantamount to me giving you life or claiming life. So I have the power and the might of giving life and taking life. This was his own distorted perception. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given him grace. I mean, Allah had given him so much grace. And this is the system of the Almighty. And let me interject here and say, sometimes we become despondent when we see the tyranny of the tyrants and we see the exploitation of autocrats. And we think, well, this type of abuse and exploitation will definitely provoke the instant wrath of Allah. And none can deny that the nature of that crime is heinous, it's horrendous, it's severe in its nature. However, we must not forget the system of the Almighty. Allah's system throughout the time has been Allah gives extended grace, extended clemency, to the extent that Pharaoh said, Dharuni. Dharuni, a verse of the 24th Juz, Surah Mu'min. And Surah Mu'min here again refers to a person who brought Iman from the family of Pharaoh. So, وَقَالَ رَجُلٌ مُؤْمِنٌ مِّنْ آلِ فِرْعَوْنِ. And a believer from the very family of Pharaoh came out, and then he defended Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam, etc., etc. But what did Pharaoh say? Dharuni, leave me, back off, just move aside. أَقْتُلْ مُوسَى, I'm going to assassinate Moses عليه الصلاة والسلام, Musa عليه الصلاة والسلام. وَلْيَدْعُ رَبَّهُ, and he's free to call his Lord, he's free to supplicate his Lord. I want to see what they can do to me. وَانْتَشَرَتِ الشُّرْطَةِ فِي مِصْرِ يُفَتِّشُونَ وَيَبْحَثُونَ. So Sheikh Abu al-Hasan al-Nadwi rahimahullah writes, the intelligence of Pharaoh, the police of Pharaoh, the army of Pharaoh were deployed everywhere. And they had a sneak peep into everyone's home, dwelling, etc. فَإِذَا عَلِمُوا مَوْلُودًا وُلِدَ فِي بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ أَخَذُوهُ وَذَبَحُوهُ كَمَا تُذْبَحُ النَّعْجَةُ. And if they would get the slightest hint or inclination or any news that a woman is expecting and there would be, she's on the family way and she would be delivering soon, immediately they would surround such a house, and if they discover it was a male issue that was born, they would immediately enter the home, apprehend the child, and mercilessly, cold-blooded in the presence of the mum, kill the her own child. And then he writes in this next paragraph, which is so amazing, وَعَاشَتِ الذِّئَابُ فِي الْغَابَةِ وَعَاشَتِ الْحَيَّاتِ وَلَمْ يَتَعَرَّضْ لَهَا أَحَدٍ وَلَكِنْ مَا كَانَ لِمَوْلُودٍ فِي بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ أَنْ يَعِيشَ فِي مَمْلَكَةِ فِرْعَوْنِ. The predators, the scorpions, the harmful creatures could live freely without anyone harassing it or without anyone interfering with it. But it was a crime. It was an unpardonable offense for a human to be born from amongst the people of Bani Israel during the reign of Pharaoh. Ya la fasad al-dhawq, what an evil situation. So any creature and any beast and any animal could live, and that was fine. But it was an offense. It was a crime of a severe magnitude to give birth to a boy, to give birth to a boy. وَذُبِحَ أُلُوفٌ مِّنَ الْأَطْفَالِ أَمَامَ أَبَائِهِمْ وَأُمَّهَاتِهِمْ. It's painful enough. It's painful enough to see your newly born child pass away. How often we see, and may Allah make it easy for one and all, a child is merely born and few hours later he or she passes away, and yet the parents cry profusely. Although it's just a newborn. Of course, the mom had 9 months carrying the child, having this dream, this vision, this hope, this excitement, etc., etc. But that attachment that Allah creates with that mom is so amazing. And likewise, the dad, in great joy, excitement, Allah referred to the father in the Quran, وَعَلَى الْمَوْلُودِ لَهُ وَعَلَى الْمَوْلُودِ لَهُ. Right? رِزْقُهُنَّ وَكِسْوَتُهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. For whom the child is born. So the affinity of the parents are just too unique. And just to see your child pass away, a natural death post-birth, is so painful. And can you imagine here where unfortunately, due to the tyranny and the tyrant and the oppression of Pharaoh, your child is killed in front of you. This was the kind of oppression of Pharaoh. وَكَانَ الْيَوْمُ الَّذِي يُولَدُ فِيهِ مَوْلُودٌ فِي بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ يَوْمًا عَسِيرًا. My word. Just look at his writing, man. And that's why I consciously opted to expound on the 39th verse to tie it up with this entire narrative as captured by Shaykh Abul Hasan Ali Nadwi rahimahullah. He says, the day a child was born in Bani Israel was literally a day of mourning, was a day of sadness, was a day of empathy and sympathy, was not a day of joy, happiness and excitement, was a funeral day, was a funeral day the day of birth. وَكَانَ يَوْمَ حُزْنٍ وَبُكَائٍ وَكَانَ الْيَوْمُ الَّذِي يُولَدُ فِيهِ مَوْلُودٌ فِي بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ يَوْمَ تَعْزِيَةٍ. We have to go and sympathize and empathize. And can you imagine, today we talk of postnatal depression, a woman recovering, etc. So she still has to go through the entire pregnancy, the panic, the fear, the anxiety. Will it be a boy or not? And if perchance it's a boy, then the fears know no limits, etc. وَكَانَ يُذْبَحُ مِئَاتٌ مِّنَ الْأَطْفَالِ فِي يَوْمٍ وَاحِدٍ كَعِيدِ الْأَضْحَى. لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. He uses an amazing expression to denote the extent of the abuse. He says, it was almost like the day of Eid al-Adha. Only the difference was on the day of Eid and the day of sacrifice, where we commemorate the sacrifice of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam, and lambs are slaughtered and animals are slaughtered and the meat is distributed. Only to say that in Bani Israel, every day when children were born was a similar feeling. They were killed, but it was not animals, it was humans that were killed and butchered. And then he brings in the verse of the Quran of the 20th juz in Surah Al-Qasas, in which Allah says, إِنَّ فِرْعَوْنَ عَلَى فِي الْأَرْضِ وَجَعَلَ أَهْلَهَا شِيَعًا يَسْتَضْعِفُ طَائِفَةً مِّنْهُمْ يُذَبِّحُ أَبْنَاءَهُمْ وَيَسْتَحْيِي نِسَاءَهُمْ إِنَّهُ كَانَ مِنَ الْمُفْسِدِينَ. My word. The way it blends in with the commentary is just too amazing. إِنَّ فِرْعَوْنَ عَلَى فِي الْأَرْضِ. Verily, Pharaoh was rebellious on the earth. He was arrogant on this earth. وَجَعَلَ أَهْلَهَا شِيَعًا. And then he divided human into categories. يَسْتَضْعِفُ طَائِفَةً مِّنْهُمْ يُذَبِّحُ أَبْنَاءَهُمْ وَيَسْتَحْيِي نِسَاءَهُمْ. He used to say, we are the upper end, we the elite class. We've been created to govern, and you've been created to be exploited, right? يَسْتَضْعِفُ طَائِفَةً مِّنْهُمْ يُذَبِّحُ أَبْنَاءَهُمْ وَيَسْتَحْيِي نِسَاءَهُمْ. So he would kill the males because a male child posed the threat, and he left the females alone for labor, for exploitation, etc., etc. إِنَّهُ كَانَ مِنَ الْمُفْسِدِينَ. Indeed, he was amongst the evil people who made mischief and evil and corruption on this earth. We move on to the next chapter in this discussion here. Wiladatu Musa. The amazing and the unique birth of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. وأراد الله أن يقع ما كان فرعون يخافه ويحذره. And Allah decreed that that very thing will happen which Pharaoh was afraid of and he was dreading. So Pharaoh was dreading and he was hoping that a child must not be born and I must not lose my kingdom. And that is precisely what Allah had decreed. And so often it happens when you have jealousy for a person, you wish, you hope, you pray for his collapse, for his downfall. And the more you try and block his growth, the more Allah gives him prosperity. The more Allah grants him acceptance. That is why, on a subtle note, as I will discuss further inshallah, the scholars say in a disguised form, the person who benefited Musa alayhi salam the most was Pharaoh. Wait and see how the tale unfolds and you will realize it yourself. So what's the message, my brother? One of my teachers used to always say, إِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الْمُقَدِّمُ وَالْمُؤَخِّرُ. It is Allah who takes someone forward, or it is Allah who keeps you back. So if Allah has decided your prosperity, nobody can hold you back. And if Allah decides to keep you back, nobody can forward you. وُلِدَ ذَلِكَ الْمَوْلُودُ الَّذِي قَدَّرَ اللَّهُ أَن يَذْهَبَ مُلْكُ فِرْعَوْنَ عَلَى يَدِهِ. The child on whose hands Allah had ordained the collapse and the decline of the empire of Pharaoh was now born. Yes, he's born and he's arrived on earth. وُلِدَ مُوسَى بْنُ عِمْرَانَ عَلَى رَغْمِ فِرْعَوْنَ وَجُنُودِهِ. Despite his dislike, despite his strategy, Musa the son of Imran. So in the Quranic context, we talk of Imran in two different tales. One was Musa alayhi salam's dad was Imran, and the other person was إِذْ قَالَتْ إِمْرَأَةُ عِمْرَانَ رَبِّ إِنِّي نَذَرْتُ لَكَ مَا فِي بَطْنِي مُحَرَّرًا فَتَقَبَّلْ مِنِّي. The father of Maryam radiyallahu anha was also Imran. The father of Maryam, and her mother is, as the scholars say, her name was Hannah. Her name was Hannah. So Allah says, when the wife of Imran, that was the father of Maryam radiyallahu anha. And likewise, Musa alayhi salatu wasalam's sister, her name was also Maryam. Just like the daughter of Imran there in that tale, her name is Maryam, and we know about the Virgin Mary and Allah speaks about it. So that's Maryam, the great woman. But the sister of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam's name was also Maryam, as mentioned by the scholars of tafsir. So Musa ibn Imran was born ala raghmi Fir'aun, wa aasha Musa thalathata ashhur ala raghmi shurta wa raqabatihim. According to this mention here in this book here, that Musa alayhi salatu was salam lived with his mom for 3 months. 3 months, and they did not apprehend and they did not intercept and they were unable to look it, because Allah had decreed it. When Allah decrees protection, then they got to the mouth of the cave and they said, no, he cannot be here. They literally came to the mouth of the cave in the search of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and they were running. Suraqa says, I was tempted by the offer of 100 camels. And so I started pursuing and moving around in the search of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And subsequently he accepted Islam, etc. The narration is recorded in the books of Sirah. But they came to the mouth of the cave and they could not find Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, because Allah had veiled them, blocked them and barred them. مَا ظَنُّكَ بِإِثْنَيْنِ يَا مَا ظَنُّكَ بِإِثْنَيْنِ اللَّهُ ثَالِثُهُمَا. What is your opinion of those two, the third of whom is Allah? The words of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam. Now comes the challenge of handing Musa alayhi salam into the chest, and the chest in the River Nile. ولكن خافت أم موسى على مولودها الجميل وكيف لا تخاف وعدو الأطفال بمرصاد. So of course, as much as She was under the protection, but a mother is a mother. There's this anxiety, there's this concern, there's this worry, and knowing very well that this woman lost a child and that woman's child was slaughtered, so it just adds to the panic and the anxiety. وَكَيْفَ لَا تَخَافْ وَقَدْ اخْتَطَفَتِ الشُّرْطَةُ عَشَرَاتٍ مِّنَ الْأَطْفَالِ مِنْ حِجْرِ الْأُمَّهَاتِ فِي أُسْرَتِهَا. From her own family and her own surroundings and precincts, there were so many a woman who lost her children. And this is the talk and this is the discussion. So the panic for every woman was great and was intense. هُنَالِكَ أَغَاثَ اللَّهُ الْأُمَّ الْمِسْكِينَةَ وَأَلْهَمَهَا أَنْ تَضَعَهُ فِي صُنْدُوقٍ وَتُلْقِيهِ فِي النِّيلِ. And now we tie up with the verse, أَنِقْذِ فِيهِ فِي التَّابُوتِ. Place him in the chest. So Allah inspired the mom, put him in a chest, and put the chest in the River Nile. Because what measures? How do you protect and insulate? Now again, he writes here so beautifully, Allahu Akbar. كَيْفَ تَضَعُ الْأُمُّ الْحَنُونُ طِفْلَهَا فِي صُنْدُوقٍ وَتُلْقِيهِ فِي النِّيلِ. For a mother, this was no less than a challenge of its own. So I'm afraid that the intelligence of Pharaoh must not infiltrate my home, apprehend my child and kill my child. But then putting my baby in a basket and putting the basket in the River Nile, logically, outwardly, apparently, is that also not a form of a test in its own way? It's a test in its own way. It's a trial in its own way. We know the fear, the phobia, the panic we have when kids are around a swimming pool and in a minute and in a second, what could happen? A child could drown in a bucket of water. May Allah grant protection to one and all. So as much as this was now a plan, but it was a challenge again in its own way. It was a challenge again in its own way. So the child, she's been told to place the child in the basket and drop the basket in the River Nile. وَكَيْفَ يَتَنَفَّسُ الطِّفْلُ فِي الصُّنْدُوقِ. The fears that haunt her. How will my child breathe there? What's the ventilation? How will my child manage? I mean, which direction will it go? What's going to happen to him therein? كُلُّ ذَلِكَ فَكَّرَتِ الْأُمُّ الْحَنُونُ وَلَكِنَّهَا تَوَكَّلَتْ عَلَى اللَّهِ وَاعْتَمَدَتْ عَلَى وَحْيِ اللَّهِ. She went through all this process. The thoughts crossed her mind, gripped her mind, anxiety. But she was told not to fear, not to panic, and to rely on the Almighty. And she mustered her courage, and she did so. And the truth be told, وَلَيْسَ الْبَيْتُ أَحْفَظُ لِلطِّفْلِ مِنَ الصُّنْدُوقِ. It's not like if the child is at home, he's safer. Or if he's in the chest, then he, you know, it's any less challenge. So either way, it was a challenge. Keeping him at home was a challenge. Putting him there was a challenge. But of course, that was in compliance with the sentiments echoed to her via inspiration. هنا الشرطة في كل مكان وعدو الأطفال بمرصاد وفعلت الأم المسكينة ما أمرها الله ووضعت طفلها الجميل في صندوق وألقته في النيل. I cannot imagine. I mean, I've seen moms at airports bidding farewell to a child who's going probably with some friends or cousins or going with a school or going with a dad for that matter, with the child's dad. And the mom is blowing a kiss and waving and tearing and holding her tears back. I don't want my child to cry, but I cannot hold back my tears. And there's communication and there's so many emotions. This is not coming to an airport to hand over and sign a document and indemnity and responsibility. Coming to the River Nile. And remember the context, let's not forget, Allah is telling this to Musa alayhi salam when he requested Allah that I'm going to Pharaoh, send my brother with me, isn't my task for me, untie my knot. Allah said, oh Musa, we've given it to you. And remember, this was the scene that was happening when you were an infant. And this was our protection measures that we had put in place. So she comes. And as he writes, وَجَزَعَتِ الْأُمُّ الْحَنُونَ ثُمَّ صَبَرَتْ وَتَوَكَّلَتْ عَلَى اللَّهِ وَأَوْحَيْنَا إِلَىٰ أُمِّ مُوسَىٰ أَنْ أَرْضِعِي فَإِذَا خِفْتِ عَلَيْهِ فَأَلْقِيهِ فِي الْيَمِّ وَلَا تَخَافِي وَلَا تَحْزَنِي. There was panic, there was anxiety, there was emotions, but then she pulled herself together, she mustered the courage, she put the little baby Musa in the basket, put the basket in the Nile, and off she seen the basket float. Let's wait and see what happens from here. May Allah grant us the beauty of the Quran.